Well, today evening promises to be another great one, as always. We at Algebra pride ourselves with that. We have three great speakers lined up for you. We all are aware right now, and we all become very careful on the social media, right? We know that the government is looking and watching at everything that we are doing. Well, we have someone among us who can even read our minds. So Karan is, so be very careful, because Karan Singh, who's going to be here with us today, may just be reading your minds too. So not only your social media, your minds will also be read. Apart from that, we have two extremely tall stature gentlemen. They're not only tall literally, but in every way. And to introduce them and to take them through the evening, it'll be Dr. Arshia Sethi, who is my colleague and moderator for the evening. Dr. Arshia Sethi is a much accomplished lady. She has arts and culture behind her. She has not only internationally, but internationally also, she loves to take forward all the conversations on art, culture, and particularly politics. So may I please welcome Dr. Arshia Sethi on the stage.
Good evening, Hyderabad. It's wonderful to be back with you again. As Rimchim just told you, I too come from Delhi, and it is a gas chamber there. So it's a pleasure to be here. But before we proceed any further with the triptych that's going to be most engaging today, I would like to congratulate each and every denizen of the city for the UNESCO recognition that Hyderabad has received as a creative city in the category of gastronomy. Yummy! So congratulations. You know that Delhi still hasn't made it into the creative cities. And I feel very bad because I helped write the first dossier that attempted to get there. And when we thought we were about to get there, the government changed and the new government had different priorities. So today you've been promised an exciting triptych. And let me invite onto the stage our first speaker. Before asking him to join us, I'd like to mention that he's a really unusual man. Tall statured, physically, very tall in his accomplishments. And I would say that he wears at least five hats. And maybe in the course of the conversation, we will discover some more that he wears. And the five that I'd like to mention is that of being a soldier, par excellence. He's been a diplomat. He has been an educationist. He has been an author. And I know I'm forgetting one of them. Well, let me call him on stage and help fill in the blank. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome General Zamir Shah, otherwise known as Zoom. So we're going to begin with General Shah first, because he has written this book. I don't know if you can see it, but if the camera could zoom in onto him, onto the book, then we can have a little telecast, a little projection. The book is called The Sarkari Musalman, The Life and Travails of a Soldier Educationist. So, General Shah, right away, I know we had discussed the five things and I missed out one. Can you tell me what I missed out? Yes. Speak into your mic.
Well, I've been a soldier for 40 years. I was a diplomat for 3.5 years in Saudi Arabia, where I was the defense attaché. After I retired, I was a judge in the Armed Forces Tribunal for 3 years. And then the community elected me as the Vice Chancellor of Aligarh Muslim University. And you'll be surprised to know that at the fag end of my tenure, Times Higher Education London and US News and World Report graded Aligarh Muslim University as the number one university of the country. And once I demitted office, I wanted to put on my thinking cap, and I wrote this book. It took me about 1 year to write. So people tell me that I timed it to affect the elections. I didn't, because during the almost 48 years of service, I never got even time to breathe. So once I finished, I wrote the book and
so we're going to begin our conversation with the book first. General Shah has been very economical with his achievements, and I'd just like to mention that normally an army person, particularly when you've risen to the rank of a lieutenant general, has a whole set of letters attached to their names, like PVSM, which is the highest peacetime recognition that an army man gets. He also has a Seva Medal, which he received for the work that he did in 2002, I think it was, in Gujarat. And the VSM, Vishisht Seva Medal, for the work that he did in insurgency hit areas of the Northeast, particularly Manipur. He was part of the 71 war, and he has been part of so many insurgency situations that this book is actually quite an engaging, important, and referential work for any of you who are scholars in the history and politics of India. But what caught my interest were two words in the title. One, the Sarkari Musalman, and the other was the choice of life and travails, not life and times, but life and travails. So I'd like to ask you first, who is a Sarkari Musalman?
Well, I selected this title because a Sarkari Musalman is a Muslim who goes by the rules, number one. That's the first variety. If you go by the rules and cannot cater to unreasonable demands of your community, you are dubbed as a Sarkari Musalman. No point going to General Shah, he's a Sarkari Musalman. The second is Muslims who have sold their souls. There are a large number of them. Salman Rushdie, born a Muslim, but he caters to Islamophobia. Taslima Nasreen, I admire her for the stand she's taken on feminism and women issues. But what disturbs me is that she's been using Islam to get an audience. So that is the second variety of Sarkari Musalmans. I am neither. I did try to go according to rules and always did, but I always kept the interests of the nation and my community in mind. I always did that. Why is it travails? Well, you know, the life of a soldier, the 40 years I spent in the army was one big experience. I mean, if people ask me, what do you want to be again? I would say, the good Lord, give me the uniform again. But in Sibi Street, I went through a large number of travails. When I was a judge in the Armed Forces Tribunal, the bench I was sharing with was a judge of the Supreme Court. And he told me, he said, General Shah, the army doesn't know justice. They do everything on the spot. I says, Justice Mathur, you are mistaken. I also clarified that army officers spend a lifetime with their troops. I mean, when I was commissioned in my regiment, I spent 20 years with them. I knew the soldiers better than their mothers. Now, if I had to punish somebody, my friend, I would think twice. So punishments don't come easy. Also, the biggest challenge I faced was as Vice Chancellor of Aligarh Muslim University. I was always in the line of fire from my own community and from the Ministry of HRD. So they were looking at the university with a jaundiced eye.
So I'd like to actually ask you a lot of questions about Aligarh Muslim University. But if I were to ask my first question pertaining to it, my question would be, tell us the interesting shift that happens, that you begin your education in a madrasa And then you go on to become the vice chancellor of the leading minority recognized national university known for its modernist stand. So bridge this period for us.
My grandfather brought me up in a place called Sardana, and I started my schooling in the village, in the family madrasa. And I'm very proud of the fact that my grounding was in a madrasa. But subsequently, my parents plucked me up and dispatched me to a boarding school in Nainital, where I came under the guidance of Irish Christian Brothers. So that was a modern secular education in a class. They were all communities. We lived together, played together, played together. And let me tell you that we are still friends. So that was the sort of atmosphere I went through. In the army, it was always secular. There were two topics never discussed in the mess. One was religion and second was women. You could talk about it in your room, but not in the anteroom. Two topics totally taboo. Nobody ever questioned who I was. Nobody ever told me, General Shah, today is an important meeting. I think you go and play golf. Nobody ever told me that. I was privy to every national secret. I wanted, when I went to Aligarh Muslim University, I found that there was a large number of conservative elements. And I wanted to modernize the university. I wanted free thought. But took care not to aggravate matters, not to irritate people who had a religious bent of mind. And I think we did. Aligarh Muslim University is a modern secular university and not a madrasa, as a lot of you would imagine.
So actually, it's quite interesting that at a time in our politics and dispensation right now, when even languages are given religious connotations, so Urdu is Muslim and Hindi is Hindu, General Shah actually came up with a very wonderful via media solution, and that was the language of the computer, which accepts no denomination at all. So I don't know if you figured out that General Shah is from a very distinguished family that has produced three great sons. He is one of them who rose to the rank of the deputy chief of the army staff. He has a brother who is an engineer, the elder one, isn't it? Yes, I mean, Zahir, who was from IIT Kharagpur. And his third brother is someone you probably know and see, and I am sure many of us admire, and that is Nasiruddin Shah. So I think everybody here wants to hear about your equation with him and some funny stories from your childhood. The book, incidentally, has some lovely pictures. I think theirs was a dream family. Three handsome young boys, eyes full of mischief. You see them growing from tiny to big. So tell us some of those stories.
Well, Nasir was the black sheep. You know, we were graded. My eldest brother always stood first in his class. I played games mostly, so I was somewhere in the middle. And Nasir always came last. So one fine day, when we were little, the people we admired were a group of uncles who were macho. And, you know, they were always carrying weapons. And for good effect, they would have a comb in their hip pockets. And they rode motorcycles and tractors. So we were little kids. And the guests asked us, and this gentleman, we always, the family sobriquet for him was loafer. He's always a loafer, an uncle of mine. So they asked us, yes, what do you kids want to be? My elder brother is very smart. He says, I want to become an engineer. So he won the brownie points. So they asked us, and both Nasir and I replied, we want to be loafers. So that really, you know, my parents were quite surprised but and embarrassed. But this is how life was. Nasir and I, both of us are interested in arts. He in the fine arts and myself in the martial arts. I think that's something which the commonality between the two of us. I can't act and he can't soldier. But we make an unbeatable tennis team. Both of us, we played matches against the army. And when I was in Aligarh Muslim University, Nasir came and I told the university professors, 1600 of them, select your gladiators and we'll play. So they did, and we beat them. And the newspaper said, who's going to lose against the vice chancellor? But I said, look, these fellows tried their best, but they didn't. So Nasir is a good human being, and I'm very fond of him. And I'm his greatest admirer. I think there's nobody who's a better actor than him.
Yes, that's true. We all believe that. And you know, it is said in India about truly gifted artists, whether they are musicians or they're dancers, or as you said, they are theater people, that they all run away from home. It is a rite of passage. And Nasir also ran away.
Yes, he ran away when he was 17 years old. Before that, while he was in the university, 16 years old, he married a woman, double his age. His teacher in the dramatics, who was in charge of he was studying in AMU, by the way. So that created a big storm. Of course, the marriage didn't last, but they have a daughter who's also an actress. So he was perpetually into trouble, but he was a great observer of human beings, and I think he's done well for himself.
You mention in the book that he watched some friend's father and then became Pestanji. You remember that film, Pestanji, where he sort of plays the role of a Parsi gentleman? He had modeled it entirely on some friend.
Yes, when I saw Pestanji, I said, Nasir, you reminded me of Jimmy Bilimoria's father. Jimmy was my classmate. He said, of course I did. I had observed him as a young boy, and the mannerism and the language which I observed Parsi gentlemen, I just did that. So he's a keen observer of human behavior. I've seen him when we travel, if he sees something odd, I find him practicing. So I said, what are you up to? Well, he says, I'm practicing just in case I get that sort of a role, I know what to play. So I think the two prerequisites of a good actor is a good memory and the ability to call back on experience.
So can we move back to your story now? And I'd like to ask you, actually before I ask, I must tell you, you know, he mentioned he was a martial artist. He was really telling you the truth, because he can do that like a Kalaripayat kind of thing. With both hands, he can swing the sword, which I think you learned in Rajasthan. Right?
That's right.
So let's talk to you about your life in the army, the highlights, starting from the Camel Corps.
Right. I was a polo player, and I got my battalion commander, who was also an artillery man, tempted me into opting for the artillery. He says, we'll put you in the artillery polo team. So I opted for the artillery, and army headquarters have their way. Instead of sending me to a horse and camel to a horse regiment, they sent me to a camel regiment. So that was the end of my dreams of polo, but I'm glad that it finished. Anyway, Captain Big is here with us. He was also Big. Can you get up?
Welcome, sir. Maybe you could corroborate some of these stories.
Captain Beg and I were in the Camel Regiment, and we fought the war together in Longewala. And that is, I've described how the war we fought. But the thing that struck in my mind is Captain Beg was in the assault on a fort called Islamgarh in Pakistani Sindh. And when it was captured, we captured it. The next day, one of the troops who had taken part came to me with a cloth-bound Quran. And he says, Captain Saab, I found this lying in the mosque, which had been destroyed by the artillery fire. And I thought it would be desecrated. And I think you would be the best custodian. So this is the way, we treat religion. We treat it with a lot of respect, but it's your private matter. Religion is your private matter in the army. I still have that copy of the Quran, and when things improve, I'll probably go back to Islamgarh and return it to the place where it belongs. That's a village called Islamgarh.
Yeah. Yes, maybe both of you should go. And maybe some of us should go as witnesses to this great moment.
And then I of course, I worked very hard, played very hard, and was selected. I commanded my regiment, same Rajput troops. As I told you, I knew them better than their mothers. And then the mistaken impression of army officers is that they are unlettered buffoons. Ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you that we may have joined as 15-year-olds after I joined after senior Cambridge, but at every stage, you have to pass promotion examinations. At every stage, you have to do year-long sabbaticals. I did three of them and did my MSc and MPhil while in the armed forces. So we are pretty reasonably well-lettered. I commanded a brigade in Manipur. It was the insurgency. I learned so many valuable lessons from my services in Nagaland and Manipur. And one of the biggest lessons, which I call, the adoption of a policy which I followed, that was Stockholm Syndrome. You've heard of the Stockholm Syndrome? Okay, I won't explain it, but Stockholm Syndrome is an affliction that a person is subjected to. A billionaire's daughter was kidnapped by the Zimbabwe Liberation Army, I think in 66 or 67.
Yes.
And the world was surprised that the next day, she, along with her captors, raided a bank. So the world was wondering, how did this girl suddenly join the Zimbabwe's Liberation Army? That happens when you don't mistreat a captive. And my policy was never, never mistreat captured captives. We all captured so many of them. And we worked on the Stockholm Syndrome in reverse. That means here, why it's reverse? Because here, the good guy is the capturer. So it was Stockholm Syndrome. And these people, the captured hostiles, gave us immense amount of information. We went into very, very successful attacks. So my view is that insurgency cannot be overcome by military action. It cannot. You've seen the example of Vietnam. The greatest military power in the world was defeated by a ragtag army of Vietnamese because they had the support of the whole population. The same way, if insurgents have the support of the majority of the population, you can do what you like. You can kill hundreds of insurgents, but you will never get a control. So the method is civic action, win the hearts and minds of the people, and you will get success. So that's a valuable lesson which I learned during my tenure in the army. And of course, it was just a wonderful 40 years.
So in the book, you describe the incident where you have a underground Naga rebel who comes up and you make him the officer or something like that.
Yes. The one act of the Prime Minister Srimati Indira Gandhi was accepting the surrender of a gang returning from China. We knew that 400 of them had spent a year in China and they were on their way back to Nagaland. An offer was made to the commandant, or who was styled himself as the chief of the Naga Federal Army, that look, his name was Zuheto Su. He's still my friend. He's alive. He stays in Dimapur. We said, we will enroll all 400 of your gang into a special BSF battalion. They will still bear their arms. And Zuheto was appointed the commandant of 111 BSF battalion. This is the way. Now, we broke the backbone of the insurgency in Nagaland, this whole gang coming over ground. And this is something I've been advocating. We can try in J&K. I know there'll be a risk. There's always an attendant risk of doing it, but it is a risk worth taking.
Thank you for sharing this story. I want to tell you, I had heard about this story from none other than my father, who was also posted at that time in, I mentioned to you, CRPF in Nagaland, and he had already told me this story. I think you guys all worked together on this story. Let me go back to some of the very interesting characters you have met in the course of your work. Sam Manekshaw, Major General Jacob, even Major Chandpuri, you know, the hero on whose life the film Border was made. Would you like to tell us a little bit about that?
Yes. First, Chandpuri, I mean, we were in the war together. He was the post commander of Longewala. My battery with Captain Beg was supporting. We were giving supporting fire. And one night, three or four khaki-clad figures came into our gun position. So we were very apprehensive because Pakistani army wore khaki. So they said, no, don't shoot, don't shoot. We are Bengali officers. They were Bengalis from the army of Pakistan who had deserted and come to the gun position. Well, Brigadier Chandpuri later, I think, did a very great amount of work by not getting cold-shouldered. He held on to the post. His CO, commanding officer, was a person called Colonel Hussain, related to Captain Beg. Unfortunately, the movie Border depicted Colonel Hussain in a very negative light. And you know what happened? The army represented, the officers of that battalion represented, this, how dare you paint Colonel Hussain in a bad light. He was the commanding officer. He gave the orders to Chandpuri not to withdraw. So that's what the army is all about. It is, religion is your personal matter. When you are serving, the only religion is your uniform. That is something which we all follow. It is the religion is uniform while we are. Now, subsequently, I became the military secretary to General J.F.R. Jacob. He's a Jew. And he told me, first time I met him, he says, you know why I selected you? I said, no, sir. He says, you look like a Pat, meaning you look like a Pathan. And you have got a very Jewish nose. Are you a member of the Lost Tribe? I told him, General, I'm not. And I'm not a Pat. And I said, sir, you have a very Arab-looking nose. He said, is that so? So that's how we parried. But ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you, I just interacted with the Bangladesh ambassador yesterday. He called me because his uncle had written to him about the book. So he gave me a call and I said, Your Excellency, I'll come and give you a copy. So I went. And he was talking about General Jacob. And I told him that General Jacob was the real architect of the victory in Bangladesh. He planned out, the initial aim of the Indian Army was to capture pockets along the border and get Bangladesh declared as an independent state. General Jacob planned otherwise. He said, we must go in for the heart of the Pakistanis, and that was Dhaka. So we left all opposition aside, and the Indian Army just headed for Dhaka, and it capitulated within a period of 2 weeks. So that was General Jacob. He followed the Israeli blitzkrieg tactics, and it worked. Now, when he wrote the book, Surrender.
This was the book General Jacob wrote.
General Jacob had written. he wrote a lot of uncomplimentary things about his army commander and about Field Marshal Manekshaw. He knew them, they were friends. And he gave me the book to edit. So I read through it and I advised him. I said, "General, don't put anything negative about the officers you have served with." I told him, I said, "Field Marshal Manekshaw is an icon in the country. And if you criticize him, you will be criticized." So he did, to a large extent, cut out the negative aspects of the generals. Now, the biggest, what really hurt him was that he didn't get credit for planning the Blitzkrieg. So he asked me, "You edit the book?" I did. Now he says, "Write comments for the jacket of the book." He wanted me to, to tell the exact story. I didn't. I just wrote that the Blitzkrieg was planned and executed by General Jacob. But I said, according to military tradition, the senior commander gets the credit for victory. And he says, Field Marshal Manekshaw was the chief. He deserves all the credit for the victory in Bangladesh. I have no doubts about it. The senior commander, people may be doing the work, but the senior commander should get the credit. And in case of a defeat, the approbation of the country for a defeat. He has to obviously resign or whatever it is to save his own honor. So that was my experience with these few military officers I interacted very closely with.
I want to now take you to a point where you write something, and it could be a very provocative moment. And this is when you go in 2002 after the Godhra riots in Gujarat, and you are sent by the army to quell the riots, which you do successfully, at the end of which you get the Seva Medal, and you write the Operation Aman report. Talk to us about this very difficult time in India's political history.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I was commanding a division. We were in Secunderabad. I was enjoying the luxury of this beautiful city. And a tenure would be about 15 to 16 months. But within 3 months of my arrival, we were moved for an operation called Operation Parakram after the attack on the Indian Parliament, because we wanted to teach Pakistan a lesson. While we were there waiting for the green signal, the Godhra riots happened. The bodies were brought in a caravan from Godhra to Ahmedabad, and that inflamed passions. This happened on 27th of February 2002. It inflamed passions. And there was large-scale rioting all over Gujarat. On 28th evening, the government requisitioned the army. And to my great surprise, the chief of army staff rang me up. Now, for a division commander to get a call from the chief of army staff meant there's something very, very important, because we have a hierarchy. We have got a command headquarters. We got a corps headquarters and then a division headquarters. The division is comprised of about 20,000 troops. So General Padmanabhan was on the line. He says, "Zoom, what are you doing?" I said, "Sir, I'm reading the papers." "Well," he says, "pack up. I want you in Ahmedabad tonight." Well, I said, "Sir, it'll take us 2 days to reach from Jodhpur, where we were positioned for the crossing the border into Pakistan." He says, "Don't worry, the Air Force is laying on the aircraft." It was such a huge effort. 59 aircraft ferried 3,000 troops into Ahmedabad. We were told to travel light because we wanted maximum troops. I had taken the precaution of taking my gypsy and my ADC and my communications. We flew in on the airfield and I found the whole town ablaze. There were fires all over the town, Ahmedabad, Anyway, we landed on a dark and deserted airfield. We had been told that we would get logistic support, we would get police guides, magistrates, and transport. The moment we arrived, not a soul was present at the airport. It was dark. Anyway, I was in the leading aircraft. I got my vehicle down. I caught hold of somebody outside and said, "Where does the chief minister live?" "Well," he says, "he stays in Gandhinagar." I said, "Get into the vehicle and show us the way." So I landed up at the chief minister, Mr. Modi's house, at 2 a.m. on 1st of March. He says, "Thank God the army has come." To my great relief, the Raksha Mantri, Mr. George Fernandez, were also there. They were having breakfast at 2 in the morning. Both were very, very concerned at what was happening. I said, "Modi sir, we don't even have maps. We need the police. We don't have transport." "Oh," he says, "sab mil jayega." So we took I had taken a tourist map. We plotted the trouble spots. And I said, "Okay." I returned back, supervised the unloading of the aircraft. But to our great misfortune, nothing happened on 1st of March. We kept waiting for the transport, for the magistrates, for the police, for the radio sets, for the maps. Nothing happened. The Raksha Mantri visited me. I apprised him. On 2nd of March, that means while we were at the airport for about 36 hours, just twiddling our toes, the logistic support arrived. And I must say with a lot of pride that within 24 hours, we had the riots under control. We had given orders. Any arsonist seen, shoot him. And we did. And that sent the lesson across that if you meddle with the army, if you go around setting fire, if you go on rioting, you will be shot. Now, people ask me, "You were at the airport for 36 hours. Why didn't you go in?" It is impossible. When you have been requisitioned by the civil administration, there's a certain protocol which has to be observed. Army columns, generals just cannot go in and shoot at will. They need a magistrate who has to certify that the shooting was necessary. You need police guides. We didn't know the gullies and the narrow ways of Ahmedabad. You need transport to move around. You need our radio sets did not work. We needed mobile sets because our radio sets were non-operational when you are in high-rise buildings. So that is why we didn't go in. Anyway, when we killed the riots within 24 hours, but it was a very, very sad experience. We had to carry out mass burials. I mean, we had to dose in graves and dose in the bodies. It was very, very painful. And I do hope that that sort of thing is never repeated.
I hope so too. And I know the bell has rung, but I cannot help coming to the last part of this conversation, which was pertaining to your period at AMU. Now, it's really interesting that recently there has been reference about putting up a tank at JNU. And here, AMU was asking a military man to come in as a vice chancellor. Tell us a little bit about it. And then, if I could ask the question right now so that you can weave that into the answer. The newspapers were rife with stories of the clash of ideologies or ideas between you and the then MHRD minister, Smriti Irani. How and why did all this happen?
AMU had been through a large phase where there had been trouble, the teachers and the students. And, you know, the vice chancellor is not appointed by the government. He is elected by the community. It is the Aligarh Muslim University court, which comprises of people of all religions, but right from the gardener to ex-vice chancellors are members of the court, 200 members. They elect a vice chancellor. they felt that a dose of discipline was required. And they approached me. This is the first time when I was the deputy chief of army staff. I put in my papers to resign, and to my good fortune, I didn't get elected. The second time, when I was a judge in the Armed Forces Tribunal, again they came to me. They said, General Saab, this time you got to come. So I said, all right. This time they did elect me. And the first thing, the reason for success was discipline. If our universities do not inculcate discipline, both amongst teachers and students, they'll do nothing worthwhile. No proper education would be carried out. Now, my first meeting with Mrs. Smriti Irani was when she was appointed as the HRD minister. And I had taken the precaution of taking my wife along. I do that. I do that whenever I'm meeting ladies. Either I keep the door open or my wife is around. And I implored, I told her, Madam, leave Aligarh Muslim University alone. Leave their minority character alone. She didn't take that too kindly. And she told students, you know, your vice chancellor, he wants to be a leader of the Muslim community. And after that, she never gave me an appointment. Once, for an issue regarding one of our centers in Kerala, I was asked by the chief minister to be present for the meeting. I landed up at the office and I was told the venue had shifted. That was in the HRD minister's residence. So I went there late. I reached late. There was a guide. So I entered. She looked up at me very disapprovingly. She said, who are you? I said, Madam, I'm General Shah. You know me. I'm the Vice Chancellor of AMU. And then she says, who invited you here? I said, the Chief Minister. It is concerning a matter of Aligarh Muslim University. Then she says something which I couldn't stomach. She says, who pays you? The central government or the government of Kerala? So I saluted her and backtracked, left the place. The chief minister, of course, apologized profusely, but he should have spoken out, but he didn't. So that was my experience. Now, I had a meeting with the prime minister some days after this on my request, where I did apprise him of the treatment meted out. And I told the Prime Minister, I said, sir, I am not only a Vice Chancellor, I am a retired general. And I have served the country, and I don't expect this sort of treatment. He heard me out. After a meeting, I requested a meeting with the HRD Minister. Now, she had never given it after our first meeting. Straight away, yes, please come tomorrow and tell me what all the Prime Minister discussed. So I reached her office, and what do I see? The complete hierarchy of the MHRD present, including three of the local members of parliament. And they tried to bully me, do all sorts of things. Anyway, I stood my ground. At the end of the meeting, I requested her, Madam, I want 3 minutes with you alone and tell you some things which I talked with the Prime Minister. Oh, she says, I'm a public person. And everything about me is public. I said, Madam, if you are saying that, let me go public of what I told the Prime Minister. And I repeated my words with the Prime Minister, and that she went red in the face. And she says, you barged into my house. I said, nothing of the sort. So that's why I called it travails. I went through very difficult times with my own community and HRD ministry.
So I'd like to end off. I know. Last question. Just jaldi se aap mujhe answer de dena, nahi to fir se ghanti baja denge ye log. And I can keep talking to you. You're an easy person to talk to. What do you think are the solution for the minoritizing that is going on around the Muslim, Indian Muslim? What are the ways in which we can look at a better future for them?
One thing is that, you know, what the Muslim community needs, they are at the lowest rung of the ladder, socio-economic, financial, everything. Every beggar, every rikshawala, every mechanic is generally a Muslim, mostly maid servants. They may have a different name when they work with you, but they are generally Muslims. We need to give them strength of education. And I'm convinced that education is the only way forward. Look, discrimination is embedded in people's hearts. But you can burst through the walls of discrimination by the armory of education. I'm convinced with that. So the way forward is not reservations for Muslims. No. The way forward is affirmative action for Muslim education. That is the only way which will rescue the Muslims from where they are. Another thing is that these television channels spewing hatred every night against the minority community need to be taken into account. They need to be checked. This sort of thing is just spreading hatred and needs to be curbed.
Well, I hope that your vision comes true of the Muslims getting empowered and progressing through education. I hope the media plays a more responsible role, and it's been a pleasure talking to you, an educationist, a soldier, and a gentleman.
Thank you. Jai Hind.